for what we have heard thus far. And we've come this far by faith. And we're asking you to continue to bless us. And Lord God, as we open your word on today, may it educate, illuminate, and change lives in the mighty name of Jesus. Touch each and every listener to the word. Touch a heart. Give the heart fire today in the name of Jesus. And out of the belly, let it flow living waters that will change someone. And we just thank you, Lord God, for all that you've done and all that you're doing. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. I don't feel no ways tired. I've come too far from where I started from. And nobody told me that the road would be easy. And I don't believe he brought me this far to leave me. This far to leave. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go with me, if you will, to Genesis 37. Genesis 37 is at the beginning of the book. Hallelujah. I shouldn't see a whole lot of flipping and fumbling today. Hallelujah. Genesis 37. Hallelujah. Beginning at the fourth verse. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Once Joseph had a dream. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream that I dreamed. There were binding sheaves in the field. Suddenly, my sheaf rose and stood upright. Then your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheep. His brothers said to him, are you indeed to reign over us? Are you indeed to have dominion over us? So they hated him even more because of his dreams and his words. So far the scriptures. Our thought for today is make space for your dreams. Make space for your dreams. The book of Genesis, which begins in the beginning God, is the first book of the Pentateuch, five books said to be written by Moses, and shares the story of Israel, God's chosen people, to carry the message of God of the universe to the people of this world. Genesis contains the stories of many contributors within Israel's trials and triumphs. The history of a people whose story shares parallels with the enslaved Africans in America. So close, in fact, that some of the passages are omitted. However, the story of Joseph, who is central to our text, is left in as to his enslavement, to portray him as one who accepts his lot in life, and continues to honor God, and is rewarded for his troubles. There will be some people who will twist this word to make it right for them. And here they want you to believe that Joseph was happy being enslaved. They said he didn't complain. He was all right with it. So when we go back and we look at our movies where we see little slave children and adults singing around the fire and they're happy and Massa been good to us, is the message. But let's think about it. Why is that message there? See, everything you see was not meant to be seen the way you see it. You gotta look with an eye, then look with a spiritual eye. The Slave Bible was written in 1807, 3 years after the Haitian Revolution ended, and the Haitians drove out their European oppressors to form a new nation. The writers didn't want any other groups getting any ideas that God was on the side of the oppressed, as noted by the father of black liberation theology, James Cone. Our text opens with Joseph, son of Jacob, who is now called Israel, a son born to him in his old age, and then that son, Joseph, having a dream. Dreams have no rhyme or reason in many cases. Some we remember, some we don't. They are a product of sleep, and yet for some, there are dreams that offer insight to things we need to know. Dreams can offer a warning of things to come, and a message to prepare for tough times ahead, or a signal that better days are ahead. We serve a God that won't keep us in the dark. Amen. You may wander a little while, but after a while, God is going to reveal out of the darkness into the light. Amen. For Joseph, the dream he had was symbolic in nature, as he told his brothers that they were binding sheaves in the field, and his sheaf rose, stood upright, and the sheaves of his brothers stood upright to bow to his. In Ecclesiastes 3 and 7, we are told that there is a time to keep silence and a time to speak. Joseph had not yet learned that lesson. So, Joseph didn't get it. And since his brothers already resented him to the point of hating him because of his father's unconcealed love and favor, silence would have been the best course of action for Joseph. The teacher's pet is not the class's favorite student. Am I right? Nobody likes a sucker.
Nope.
Nobody likes a snitch.
Nope.
Is that clear enough? Joseph's revelation of his dream started a chain of events that took Joseph into the rabbit hole as his future was being processed. As our ancestors were taken from the villages and towns in Africa, stripped of language, community, and customs, there were many dreams and dreamers among them who saw and imagined their lives differently than they developed. A young Kunta Kinte and Alex Haley's roots developed dreams of being free from enslavement. Taking a minute to examine the word dream. A dream can come from our sleep, as well as a dream can be defined as a desire, a wish, a circumstance of fulfillment, a change of fortune, or an actualization of thought. Right now, there are young people who have dreams of being basketball stars or rappers, individuals who try out for reality shows like American Idol with a dream of being selected in auditions to have the shot of being the American Idol, the last one standing. And they want to see the confetti fall. They're dreaming. There's nothing wrong with dreaming. There are those dreams of looking to go beyond their present circumstances to what they perceive as greatness. Those dreams can keep the light behind the eyes, as scripture reminds us that without a vision, the people perish. So there has to be a time when you begin to dream of a thing that may not have occurred, a thing that you desire. I want certain things to happen. I need certain things to happen. And then I wake up in the morning looking for that thing to happen.
Amen.
It gets me out of bed in the morning.
Yeah.
I'm on my way to find my dream. And for everyone who has that desire, there are others who have no dreams, who feel locked in and locked out. They have not yet found a way to fulfill their purpose. And that's a dangerous thing, because if you don't find a way or a need to get up in the morning, your life becomes wasted. You need something that pulls you up, something that gets you going in the morning, something that keeps you moving throughout the day, something that motivates you when others around you may not have anything going on. The difference between the haves and the have-nots is the haves have a dream. And then the have-nots may have lost that dream along the way. They might have had a dream at one time. If you interview the homeless, there are many who had successful careers, successful lives, as we see success. But something happened along the way. And as something happened along the way, the dream had been put to the side. Our history includes men and women who may not have used the terminology dream as Dr. King did, but it was Harriet Tubman's dream of seeing others free that drove her to risk her life to make it happen, including working for the Union Army during the Civil War. And it was Thurgood Marshall's determination to see justice served with the case of Brown versus the Board of Education and declaring segregated schools unconstitutional. It was the actress Regina King who recently said, "I want a full life, period." And what does that mean? We may not know what that means, but we know what the word full means. And we know what the word life means. And if you want a full life, you gotta do some things so life can become full. If you just sit around in front of the television and never get up except to get a beverage, then you won't have much of a full life. I'm reminded of a commercial where the boy is playing his video game, and he calls to his grandmother who's in the other room. He calls her on the phone, and he says, "Grandma," she said, "Yes, could you bring me a soda?" Well, it says that he has no real desire. And that if grandma brings him the soda, she's not helping her grandson. So a dream has to have more than what we see. I want a full life, period. That would seem like a reasonable expectation. But for many in our community, it is a dream and not an automatic reality. So dreaming without intentionality doesn't make it so. So we must speak it into existence. Bible tells us that faith without works is dead. If you don't speak life into your situation, you won't have much of a situation. If you don't speak prosperity into those things that you desire, how can you obtain them? When God made man, he said he blew into him and into the dust. There was an action that created man. Man just didn't come out of the imagination of God, but it came through an action of God. Oh, I hope you hear me this morning. We have to make a contribution into our dreams with good habits and consistency. The end will have to justify the means sometimes, because there are times when you get a little weary. We look at our kids, our children, and we say to them, "Don't you want more?" And they go, "Yeah, but it's hard to get more." Well, it's hard to get more when you haven't put anything into it. And if you want to see the end of a thing, you've got to work to see the end of a thing. If you want to see good out of something, you've got to put something good into it. If you want to see life, you've got to push life into the thing that you wish to see. You just can't leave things just as they are and say, "Oh, I believe better days are coming." Well, better days will not be coming for you if you don't put anything in to make those days better. Somebody said, "Well, I'm saving for a rainy day." That's how you make things better.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, my God, my God.
Amen.
There have been many roadblocks to our dreams as the black community. I recently came upon a new term for me. It said one-way busing. Where in the 70s in Portland, Oregon, black students were bused into white schools while white students attended black schools on a voluntary basis. So I don't know how many volunteers were open for that. And then they gave them incentives, hoping that they would go. Well, what happened is, knowingly by some and unknowingly by others, the responsibility to become a change agent was left solely to the black students. What do you mean, preacher? Dreams have to be supported. No one can bring their dreams to fruition without help. So imagine these black students carrying the load and the white students not having the same experience, and by not having that experience, became less inclined to think or act differently. See, you've got to have a catalyst in order that something might be something more. We were talking about that last night, that the dynamite needs a switch, a fuse, to be lit in order to be dynamite. Other than that, it's just a long tube with gunpowder in it. But with a fuse and a match, then you get dynamite. Then you get the explosion that comes from dynamite. And a lot of times we say we want things, but we're not willing to put in the work. And if you're not willing to put in the work, you cannot see the outcome. If you want to be a great pianist, you've got to sit down at the piano every day for 2 or 3 hours at a time. And you got to practice things over and over again until you know them by heart, that you can close your eyes and you can see the notes and you begin to play, and then music becomes reality. My God, my God.
Amen.
Amen.
We will never see the dreams of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, Freddie Gray, George Floyd, and Tyree Nichols, and countless others actualized through their eyes because their opportunities were taken away. And in that space, they have become Black history in a way that doesn't get appreciated or celebrated because of the way they left us. We would like to see what would have happened to some of these people if they were allowed to see their dreams be played out. But sometimes the enemy will come and the enemy will stand in your way, because my Bible tells me that Satan has come to kill, to steal, and to destroy. And he's come to kill, to steal, and destroy everything that God had planned for you. God had plans for you. I read that in Jeremiah. I've got plans for you. I may have sent you into exile, but I had plans for you once your exile was over. Once you began to learn that I am God and there's nobody like me. But you've got to know that in order for these things to happen, in order for your dreams to happen, you've got to make room for your dream. Oh my God. I don't know about you, but I get tired of saying what if. Senseless violence kills dreams, just as some of the infiltrators in our communities kill dreams. Drugs, alcohol abuse, domestic violence, poverty, prison, limited access to education, and others too numerous to mention here. Now, when we think of our text, when we think of Joseph, we see that it took years to develop his maturity and ability to become the man in charge, taking care of those who were impacted by the famine in the land, which included his fathers and brothers. The vision or dream God gave him became lost in his boastful youth, because he would just sort of brag to his brothers, because he knew dad was in his pocket. He knew that daddy had his back. He knew that he was the favorite. You will never hear the words out of my mouth that you are my favorite child, because I know what the others will do to the favorite child. I'll let it be perception, because perception will always be true to each one of us. But as soon as you speak it into existence, now you start to put up the barriers that block that person's future.
That's right, that's right. My Lord, my Lord. Yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah.
His brothers hated him for sharing the dream and setting himself up for the jealousy to follow.
Yes.
Sometimes you set yourself up because you can't keep your mouth shut. You got a dream, and you run around and you want to share it. I know you're happy, but I tell you what, sometimes being happy is not enough. You got to keep it on the inside. Let it bubble up from the inside, but don't let it blurt out from the outside. Keep it to yourself, and when it's time, it is then time for you to say, look what the Lord has done. But as long as you keep your mouth shut, as long as you keep your mind on the work, then God can be working around you to create the better thing that you're working on. Don't get lost in trying to be important, because if you continue to wait, God will reveal it in due time. This teaches us to make space for our dreams. Borrowed from a comment by actor Aisha Taylor, heard her the other day, and I hope she won't mind. It is said we are what we eat. And some will ask, what does that have to do with dreams? Glad you asked me. Dreaming is fine because it increases your desire to live, to fight, and to create. Dreaming allows us to plan, prepare, and pursue what's on the inside of us. What we consume by conversation and association, it helps and it affects our spiritual diet. It manifests sometimes in poor nutrition when you're talking to the wrong person. Because sometimes you're talking to the wrong person and they know you're a diabetic and they offer you some sugar because they say it won't harm you. Just take a little bite. Meanwhile, what they're trying to do is sabotage your dream. They are trying to make sure that you don't get to where you gotta go. Some people are just waiting to find your weakness. And sometimes, like Samson, you talk too much and you tell them exactly where to go. Sometimes you just gotta know what you know and let them guess about it. I'm not going to allow you to kill me by my own hand, because that's what I call a self-inflicted wound. And I'm not going to do that to myself. Because a dream has to be nourished. It has to be nurtured. And just like a flower that is killed off by weeds or the lack of weeding, we must surround ourselves with those who will support our need to grow and develop. In other words, we gotta push away the people who block our dreams and stand in the way of the successes that God wants for us. If every time I come to you or you come to me, you come with rain and you wanna rain on my parade, eventually I'm getting my umbrella and I'm getting out of your way, because you're not gonna bring more rain on me and dampen everything that God has put before me. You won't do that to me. I've got to make room for my dreams. I've got some plans. God gave me in a dream and he started knowing me things. And as God started showing me things, he also will give me the wisdom to carry out the dream. And you know what I saw in the dream? Or you know what I didn't see in the dream? I didn't see you, but you weren't meant to be there. If you were meant to be there, I'd have seen you, but you weren't meant to be it. So God said, you got to leave. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. Get out of my way. Stop blocking my dreams. I'm making way for my dreams to happen. Oh my God. Langston Hughes asked, what happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Or does it fester like a sore and then run? Some of us have had dreams, and I will add, when we were younger, and then along came, be careful for this, Janet, Sequisha, Johnny, Bill, life named Mary Jane, Ganja, Giggle Juice, Moonshine, Hooch, the Bloods, the Crips, the Latin Kings, the Zulu Nation, names that have and will kill your dreams. Just like the KKK and Jim Crow worked against the dreams of our ancestors. Age and time, they jump or defer a dream, when we don't move quickly enough or act divisively. So what's the answer, preacher? When I'm no longer fast, when I no longer can see as well as I did and move like I used to. Well, one of the answers lies in Romans 12, 1 through 4.
I'm gonna wait until my chance.
vision has to come to pass. I trust that God hasn't finished with me yet.
Amen.
Hang around me, and I'll show you how to make space for your dream.